Frank's work has been really important to me and my writing, my thinking, and I've started to put him in my writing, and I've started to put him in my classes. Somebody who's very important to me in terms of just how I'm thinking about blackness and racism or anti-blackness. And I don't say racism anymore, I just say anti-blackness. But so I just wanted to thank you, Frank, for all your work. And also just the person that you are, it's been really great and much appreciated. So with that, I'm just going to introduce Frank. Frank B. Wilderson III is the Chancellor's Professor of African American Studies Department at UC Irvine. During the apartheid era, he spent 5.5 years in South Africa, where he was one of two Americans to hold elected office in the African National Congress. He was a cadre in the underground. His books include Incog Negro, Memoir of Exile and Apartheid, winner of the American Book Award, the Zora Neale Hurston Richard Wright Legacy Award, and a National Endowment for the Arts Literature Fellowship. Red, White, and Black, another book of his, Red, White, and Black, Cinema and the Structure of U.S. Antagonisms, and Afropessimism, which is what he's going to talk about today, was long listed for the National Book Award. Wilderson was educated at Dartmouth College, Columbia University, and UC Berkeley, where he got his PhD in rhetoric and film studies. Can we give a big welcome to you?
Even if its author has some difficulties with the ways in which we've appropriated it. I'm sure even Franz Fanon right now is rolling over in his grave given what we've done with his work. But we read in that class, we read Slavery and Social Death. And one of the most important things about that book is that it changed the dynamic, changed the conversation, at least in at a higher level of abstraction in the academic world, and I think through Afropessimism, that conversation is starting to change in political circles as well, in terms of actually what is slavery by definition, as opposed to what is slavery at the level of history or its sort of lived experiences. And about this time, when I was recalibrating my thinking, and the argument through people like myself and Jared Sexton was being gleaned from texts where it existed in kind of sometimes larger forms, sometimes fragmented forms, the chapter on slave women and rape in Sylvia Hartman, my dissertation advisor's book, Scenes of Subjection, David Norris' work on psychoanalysis and ethnic black violence, Hortense Thurber's major works. We began to think about slavery through Orlando Patterson as a relational dynamic and as something that still exists as a relational dynamic if you think of it in the way that Marx began to think of political economy, abstractly as opposed to experientially. And so that then began to help us think through problems and the disconnect between blacks and others in multiracial political coalitions that we were working with in Oakland and San Francisco. It also helped us to make a meta, META, critique and intervention into the assumptive logic of psychoanalysis and Marxism to help us understand why it is that a universal kind of paradigm of suffering cannot apprehend the nature of black suffering and anti-black violence in particular. So I'm going to stop this part right now, because what we've been trying to do, I guess, yesterday and today, is to actually get to the film, which is a kind of, let me put it like this. At this particular time, around 2003, 2004, as I'm beginning to write my dissertation and working productively in a kind of tension against the logic of two mentors, Katja Silverman, who taught me about psychoanalytic white feminism, and Ruth Lee Gilmore, who was a Marxist geographer, and working through and against their sense of logics, and then trying to deepen my understanding of what Sylvia Hartman was saying, to tease out first principles and protocols of a lens of analysis that would explain black suffering in a way that was sufficiently comparative with the structure of other of subaltern suffering to say why these two paradigms of suffering are irreconcilable. At this particular point in time, my wife and I, Anita Wilkins, took a documentary filmmaking class, and I thought it might be interesting in this class to produce a short film in which I asked different black people in the Bay Area what slavery meant to you in your life at this moment in time. The responses that I got, about 2 hours of interviews for each person, which I helped with the help of someone else, editing down to about 2-4 minutes for each person. At first, I was very disappointed because I felt that everyone had in some way been hit by the question and then avoided it. But in me looking at the interviews, what I realized was that everyone was answering the question in symptomatic ways. And that for me was really quite, traumatic and on the level of understanding what was being said, and at the same time rewarding in the sense that the interviews brought up something that was really important. So what I'm going to do, what we're going to do, is show the film. Then I'm going to share a passage from Afropessimism that resonates with the first principles and protocols of Afropessimism without getting too theoretically abstract. And then we'll open it up for your comments. All right?
Can you do the light? Should I do the lights?
Hi. Hello? know, you won't believe this. It's a Sunday. The birds are singing. The sun is shining. I've got my low-fat decaffeinated latte in one hand, Sunday New York Times in the other. I'm wearing penny loafers, no socks, of course. Khaki pants from Banana Republic, Pierre Cardin shirt. No, this shirt's not Pierre Cardin, but it was. Cashmere sweater top. No, this is not a cashmere sweater, but I had a cashmere sweater. I'm seated in my favorite. What did you say? Am I out on parole? No, I am not out on parole. Is your stanky ass out on parole? I didn't think so. Why I got to be out on parole? Do I got out on parole written on my forehead? I didn't think so. Hi. You won't believe this. It's a Sunday. The birds are singing. The sun is shining. I've got my low-fat, decaffeinated latte in one hand. The Sunday New York Times in the other. I'm wearing penny loafers. No socks, of course. Khaki pants from Banana Republic. Pierre Cardin shirt. Cashmere sweater tied around my neck. I'm seated at my favorite, the laundromat. When the clothes get done washing, I go with my designer basket, it's a very upscale laundromat, over to the washing machine, I put the clothes in, I wheel the designer basket all the way back over to the dryer, and I put them in the dryer. I put the quarters in, and I sit back down with my low-fat, decaffeinated latte and my Sunday New York Times. When the clothes get done, I bring them out, back in the designer basket, over to the designer table. I begin to fold them when all of a sudden, this, I make it run. And did I have a receipt for the clothes? No, I did not have a receipt for the clothes. Why did I not have a receipt for the clothes? Because you don't bring receipts to the laundromat. You bring quarters and detergent. Why did I have a receipt for my clothes? Hi. You won't believe this. It's a Sunday. The birds are singing. The sun is shining. I got my low-fat decaffeinated latte in one hand. The sun in your times in the other. I'm wearing penny loafers. No socks, of course. Khaki pants from a narrow public. Pierre Cardin shirt. And yes, it's mine. Cashmere sweater. And yes, it's cashmere. And no goddamn, I'm not allowed to roll. I was going to tell you a crazy story about this crazy white woman who came to the laundromat when I was folding clothes and out of the blue started accusing me of stealing
down here below.
He told me it was a plantation that had owned us when we were slaves. Suddenly it occurred to me, what if the people who owned the White Castle plantation in Louisiana were the same people who owned White Castle hamburgers in Minneapolis? And I loved White Castle hamburgers. Maybe they'd give me a lifetime supply, seeing as how we were their slaves. Or if they wouldn't keep me in White Castle hamburgers for the rest of my life, maybe they'd give me a summer job. Or at least spring for a gift certificate. Some token of appreciation for all that work.
I'm feeling isolated. I'm feeling alone. I'm feeling no support. At first, I didn't even have a name for the anxiety attack. I thought I was having a heart attack. And this academic job will kill you. Look at black folks. When we're the only one, look at those poor people that were integrated in all those schools. They have trouble. They have problems. We want to make you homogenize. And maybe because you can't homogenize me, you know, I'm having more difficulty than other people. My presence is a statement. My presence is like, who wants to associate with somebody like me? It would mess up their tenure. It would mess up their benefits because it's not popular to be black in America. I thought, well, now I'm 10 years back and I got home. I thought I had a home. I did, you know, feel dedicated to my students. I have integrity around my position and my job, even if others didn't believe me. But last year, you know, I'm like jumping in, now I'm like, what am I, a company woman? I should have, you know, that never works for black men. Alameda is in a real provincial kind of environment, you know, real small, closed community that I did not know was like this. It's not just a small, closed community in smart people live here, it's a small, closed community that leaks into the institution. So I'm putting on this program, you know, for the Maafa. And I'm thinking, okay, the Maafa is for black people. It's for us to remember what happened to our ancestors and give our ancestors a funeral. And white people are not invited to the ritual. And we don't care if they come to anything else. Man, we don't care. It's like, ooh. And I'm like, I have literature that says black people only on. And so I'm sharing that with my colleagues here at the College of Alameda, and they are not happy. One college threw went on the floor. I'm like, no, I'm not giving this to my students. I'm like, oh. We had 7 events. The only one they couldn't come to was ritual. What we were doing, I asked them, we're giving them a funeral, a sunrise ceremony. And that's the only thing they couldn't come to. Because they came, I would have told them to get the heck off the beach. Even though I don't own the beach, I owned it that morning. I own that space. And these are my assets, and I was like, thank you, goodbye. So I told them, don't come, because you might have your feelings hurt. And I would take you the lead. We had a ride up into the Lady College Tower to explain the Ma'afa. But, you know, things were never the same after that. I was surprised and shocked. And he wasn't the only one, he was the only one that threw it at me. But other people looked at me weird. And then you think you have an ally in a non-African person, and you don't. You know, we got disagreements, we talk about it somewhere else. You don't diss me in the forum. We're always together. You always have my back. I always have your back. That's black folks do that. You know, because we're in a guerrilla war, you know? And we're soldiers. That's my father taught me. And we never break rank. Never. So anyway, yeah, God, I'm feeling this. Man, I'm getting sad. Maybe that's what kills the hostility. Hostility is something you can measure. Within my department, I have to be really careful. Within the all college community, I don't say anything anymore. I make myself an invisible person. You know, like the spook who sat by the door, only I'm not a spook. Or invisible man, although I'm not invisible because I'm just too visible, but I can't keep my mouth shut. For me, my stomach's hurting. You know, right now, if I remember this, my stomach's hurting. And I'm having an anxiety attack.
My mother never mentioned slavery. She was born and raised in a debutante ball. When King was killed, she wrote a letter to the white people of Kenwood, which is to say, she wrote a letter to everyone, for everyone was white, save us. My sister and I walked with her end to end, stuffing boxes. That winter was late in leaving. And I can still feel the chill of salt and slush seeping through my shoes. In April, 37 years will have passed since we hand-carried those letters. Another spring of no reply.
I just didn't really want to talk to them about slavery and stuff. I didn't want kids to know nothing. My mother didn't really tell us nothing about slavery, but you seen it. Why don't y'all go back to where you came from? You know, and all this stuff about going back to Africa. I ain't never been to Africa in my life. Anyone else would sit down and know it and be laughing and stuff about sitting on a milk crate. And these police officers didn't want us to do it. Police officers, I thought they were black, but they said they were, no, they're not black. They was from some other little country or something. And the talk chief of police said that they weren't even supposed to be up there, the ones on these bicycles. They weren't even supposed to be up there doing that to us. Man, it hurt. Because I thought the police was, you know, would help us, but they didn't. A lot of this stuff they're saying is believed. And she waited out on the street, and I'm hollering to tell her that there are cars there. She's looking at me like, I'm asking, say, your name, Laura, I'm casting her. And she's just looking at me because I'm black. He was looking at me. And then I walked across and said, Big Mara, I said, here, you got your car up there in the back. And then she said, thank you, smiling and grinning, and that was it. She could at least give me a dollar or something. Got ready to go, she could have got in her car. It was a brand new car. The woman had it, wouldn't give me a dollar. Things that they say up here to you, look at you, like they do it now. Blacks. And I mean, they do. They all hate black people. I don't know why we're such a hated race. And then, you know, the blacks give jobs now, and they got us all off welfare, and they give it to the people with the kids with the brown skin and the blue eyes. And some kind of look. Well, you have to see this. I mean, I know most of you blacks seen this look, how these white people look at you, that hate look. And then what gets me, this hatred is still here. It's still here, all these years, and they still hate. As I get older, I'm just getting tired. I'm real tired of stuff. This hatred, I mean, this same thing, I mean, the same hate. Just hate black people. And my, we are so hated. I'm trying to tell people how this is. They really don't believe it.
My sister and I were the only blacks in our neighborhood. Negroes in 1962. I tried talking to Dad about the time in fourth grade when the white kids came to school with their family trees. Five or six of them even had coat of arms pasted to the cardboard presentation. Some trees went all the way back to the Vikings, the speed of Minneapolis. I said to my dad, since you were there on the White Castle plantation, do you know how we got the name Wilderson? We were sitting at the kitchen table. He knocked back the last of his Jack Daniels. The glass came down on the kitchen table a little too hard. He said, at the end of the Civil War, the master came out and told the slaves that people in the free world had surnames. If they were going to live in the free world, they all had to have surnames too. So there were two rows of slave quarters with a lane down the middle. He stood in the middle of the lane and waved his hand to the left and said, I name y'all Wilson. And he waved his hand the other way and he said, I name y'all Wilderson. Then my dad looked at me and he said, now you know.
When the day passed into the Capitol, the house was boiling over with fury, you know, just, you know, discussing ways of, you know, should we ram a truck through this dorm room? I mean, you know, should we confront him on the street? You know, and the theory was that the university didn't support us at all, at all. We had a case in which a white student at Berkeley was party to the rape and murder of a little black girl. And the university took the stance that because he had not violated any laws, any Nevada laws, that the university's hands were tied because it could not rule on issues of personal morality. And that was the biggest crock of shit I've ever heard. Of the university that had taken away, that was trying to take away affirmative action at that time, and arguing that that black students were in some essential way unqualified to leave the university, could turn around and make an argument that a white student who had raped and killed a little black girl, it could not make a moral judgment about, was the clearest statement of where black students stood relative to the University of California, Black University. And the thing that I was struck by was how polarized the student body was. It seemed to me that this was a fairly clear moral case. If you can't agree that the guy who admitted to raping, you know, to being a party to the rape and murder of a little black girl should not deserve to, you know, be at this university, I don't want to talk to you. And, but not only was that the case, David Cash had groupies, you know, like people, girls, sorority girls, or white women crying, you know, that David Cash was a victim, that this was the example of white victim, you know, of what they as white people experience as victims of black aggression at Cash. And that was something that was deeply shocking and very troubling to this day. It's still, how any argument that black people have, no matter how clear it is, will be twisted by the opponents of affirmative action, by the opponents of Black humanity, into some kind of, you know, aggression against them. It is an aggression against their racism. And if they feel victimized by our fight against, you know, their lack of recognition of our humanity, then, you know, I guess they're gonna feel like victims. You know, here we are carrying our blackness and we're fighting against huge, gigantic political forces which span the whole country. And we're the epicenter of that. And you have someone like David Cash, because we're against him, the forces that disagree with him cut for him. David Cash was able to take on the entire Black community after having committed and admitted to an egregious crime. It really caused me to reflect on how far we've really come. He literally left them. And our attempts to fight against that was met by contempt by the university, by other students. And even our little home that we had there was only greeted uneasily, you know, by the rest of the university community. So we really have to think that we were kind of out there, all alone. I felt no protection against the storm.
Which is
and these are the three elements. General dishonor means that the person who is socially dead is dishonored in their being, not dishonored in their historical resistance to the symbolic order or the rules or the laws of the day. And that is a condition of subjugation for which it's conceptually impossible to find a way to repair that. And so the t-shirt that I used to wear from Incorporated said, reparations now, with an exclamation mark. And the more I began to think, what has happened cannot be conceptualized or apprehended through a kind of interpretive mechanism of loss, because there is no loss in social death. It's an absence of the elements which allow for someone to be someone. So those are the key constituent elements of slavery, which make it very different than post-colonial subjugation and very different from working class subjugation. And I thought to myself, well, the ellipsis, reparation dot dot dot, is better suited as a title to apprehend or to title a series of interviews from people who are basically experiencing different things, but all the same structure, which is that they cannot be seen as subjects of humanity. I will say a little footnote about the last vignette there, which I sometimes introduce because it's historical. What Adrian Bankhead, the former student from the University of California, Irvine undergraduate, was talking about was a dust-up between black students and other people in the, other students and people in administration at UC Berkeley, either in 95 or 94, in which two white male undergraduates had gone to Las Vegas on a spring break. And he's talking about David Cash, who is now, I believe, a software programmer in Silicon Valley. The last I checked, about 10 years ago. So my point is that they were in the casino, and David Cash's buddy lured a black girl about 11 years older, and lured and then pulled her into the men's room and sexually abused her and then murdered her in the men's room. And David Cash stood guard outside the door to make sure that no one would go in while this was happening. And if he was across the state line in California, that would be a Class A felony accessory to homicide. But it actually didn't fall into accessory to murder in the state of Nevada. So his friend stayed there and was convicted and did big time for the murder, and he came back to school. And so the point that Adrian was making, and he was, I believe, chair of the Black House at Cal, was that they were petitioning the Chancellor of the University of California to at least expel David Cash for this. And most of the, who can say most of it, all the people who were vocal and the administration themselves said, well, no, we can't, because he hasn't actually broken any California laws, and we can't make a moral judgment on his behavior. So that was the episode that he was talking about. The first one, of course, was pretty straightforward, where Wanda Sabir had wanted to do a series of programs at Laney Community College for the MAFA, which is the disaster or the Middle Passage. And one of them was that she was going to go to the Presidio, if those of you who know San Francisco, and have a ceremony to the sea for the ancestors that were in the ocean, and there was a series of other events, like speaking events like this one and others throughout Laney Community College that week, and she was bringing a brochure with these events to the English department,
The last one, the sunrise ceremony at the of the MAFA, was for black people only, and the English department started yelling at her. It was reverse racism. they were excluded from this. And then one male professor threw the brochure in her face and walked out of the meeting. So, and then Carolyn, who is houseless, was, I think her testimony was pretty self-evident. So now what I want to do is read a couple of vignettes. This book is titled Afropessimism, and it's I think the genre is called auto theory, like Maggie Nelson's The Argonauts, or some of you had read Asada Shakur's autobiography. It weaves in between political and theoretical discourse and in and out of memoir. And so what I can never know where the audience is. Sometimes a lot of people have read the work of Jared Sexton, Sadia Hartman, and sometimes I say these names and no one knows who they are. funny little story actually happened in Portland about 12 years ago. My first book came out, Incognito, A Memoir of Exile and Apartheid. I did 38 cities and about 50 readings in less than 18 months. It was a grueling, grueling tour. And the first stop was Powell's books. And I had not published a book before then, and not very many articles. But I had written an article called Gramsci's Black Marx, where I began to interrogate the assumptive logic of hegemony and from the position of blackness. So it was a highly theoretical intervention into Antonio Gramsci's prison notebooks. Which I was not there to talk about. I might come here to talk about that, okay? I was there to have a nice reading of stories. And so right about here, there are about 30, middle class, well-dressed but casual white people. They've probably been out for dinner on that long green, what is it called? Park Place?
Park.
Park blocks, yeah. It's the only thing that my wife and I know about Portland, because we always eat at a shishi restaurant when we come there on our way to Canada. So they look like they've been there. And that was the crowd, because they actually buy books. But then 10 anarchists, all dressed in black, sat in the very back row, And I knew this because, from time to time, we would come up here when they would have Ward Churchill speak and different types of events, mainly to hear Ward Churchill. And my heart just sunk because I knew this was going to be a very, very irreconcilable crowd here. Kind of before that, in the remnants of the Occupy movement, the movements, the things that happened after that, this one little article called Gramsci's Black Marx had been circulating amongst anarchist collectives, and and been mimeographed and in tents and different places like that, and so these questions up front were like, so where do you get your inspiration? Do you write with a pen or a typewriter? what was it like meeting Nelson Mandela? And the first chapter of that book talks about Nelson Mandela putting him on an assassination list because he was trying to purge the ANC of the ultra left. So all these people were Mandela worshippers, and I'm saying, well, he's a fucking sheepdog for the consensus that's going to let capitalism. he's capitalist's best friend in South Africa, And what? And so I actually didn't say it like that. but then someone dressed in black in the back raised their hand, okay. To actually understand the question, you would not have only had to have read Gramsci, but you would have had to have read Antonio Negri, as well as the group of Autonomia Italian feminists who challenged them from 68 to 1980. It was a highly complex abstract question. And the people from started to groan, you know. And right over there where Ethan is sitting was the bookstore owner. And he was seeing no sales, you know. So these questions were really nice softball questions, hit them out of the park, you know, make people want to buy the book, you know. And they asked questions that literally took about 2 or 3 minutes to get through. So that was a very interesting evening. I assume that we're probably more coherent as a group tonight. But I won't I'll go more into the story and lead into the theory, and then I'll read two vignettes, and then we'll open it up, and then you can start talking, and I'll see what is important for you. So the basic purpose of these two vignettes is to, the purpose of the film was to kind of show what it feels like to be natally alienated, dishonored in your being, generally dishonored, and available to the whims of society, generally dishonored, gratuitous violence and natal alienation, which one of the things that Afropessimism argues is that the structure or the paradigm of anti-blackness, and Ethan made these points in his opening remarks, may have the same performative force of violence as what comes out of the structure and the paradigm of white supremacy, but they are theoretically irreconcilable. And one of the things that I want to get at today is how that irreconcilability between the grammar of black suffering and the grammar of suffering of other people who are not black and might not be white either, what that irreconcilability looks like up close and in a kind of symptomatic exchange. So in this particular point, I'm 32. It's not now. You should have said, oh yes, you are. I tell my students that you're ready to get an A, you know. Actually, I'm not, I'm 66. But I was 32 in 1988. You thought that was funny, huh? I really was. Yeah, in 1988. And I have a best friend who and we're doing political work in Minneapolis for the first Intifada. We also work as guards at the Walker Arts Center in Minneapolis, telling kids not to touch the paintings. So, a high grassy knoll abutted the building that housed the Walker Arts Center. Am I still being heard in the back? Yes, okay. A high grassy knoll abutted the building that housed the Walker Arts Center. The knoll is gone now, scalped clean as a root canal to make room for a restaurant. But when it was still a hill, Samir and I would take our lunch there. In springtime, when the cold broke and the sky cleared, the hilltop commanded a sweeping view of white swans tracing Loring Park Lake. Distant cars in downtown streets sparkled like sequins in the sun. And from that knoll, you could see the Basilica of St. Mary's copper dome corroded by melted snow and driving rain to a blue-green brilliance that made me think ruin was the only true object of love. The knoll was also a vantage point from which death in the making would be seen. Just below it was the bottleneck, an intersection where three streets converge into one, a place where some of the most horrifying collisions occurred. As a tween reading spy novels, I used to imagine the bottleneck as a stretch of the German Autobahn where John le Carré's ill-fated spy, Alec Liamas, saw two young children waving cheerfully from the window of a small car, and the next moment saw it smash between two large lorries. That hill was where Samir told me about his cousin who was killed in Ramallah, blown up while making a bomb. But he wasn't a suicide bomber. It was an accident. Samir blamed himself the way that survivors often do, no matter how near or far in space and time they are from their dead. He survived by being here and not there. My friend spoke openly as we watched the world below us rush by without even looking up to pay its respects. At one point, Samir spoke of being stopped and searched at Israeli checkpoints. He spoke in a manner that seemed not to require my presence. I hadn't seen this level of concentration and detachment in him before. That was fine. He was grieving. The shameful and humiliating way the soldiers run their hands up and down your body, Samir said. Then he added, but the shame and humiliation runs even deeper if the Israeli soldier is an Ethiopian Jew. The earth gave way. The thought that my place in the unconscious of Palestinians fighting for their freedom was the same dishonorable place I occupied in the minds of whites in America and Israel chilled me. I gathered enough wits about me to tell him that his feelings were odd, seeing how Palestinians were at war with Israelis, and white Israelis at that. How was it that the people who stole his land and slaughtered his relatives were somehow less of a threat in his imagination than black Jews, often implements of Israeli madness, who sometimes do their dirty work? What, I wondered silently, was it about black people, about me, that made us so fungible we could be tossed like salad in the minds of oppressors and the oppressed? I was faced with the realization that in the collective unconscious, Palestinian insurgents have more in common with the Israeli state and civil society than they do with black people. What they share is a largely unconscious consensus that blackness is a locus of abjection to be instrumentalized on a whim. At one moment, blackness is a disfigured and disfiguring phobic phenomenon. At another moment, blackness is a sentient implement to be joyously deployed for reasons and agendas that have little to do with black liberation. There I sat, yearning in solidarity with my Palestinian friends, yearning for the full restoration of Palestinian sovereignty, mourning in solidarity with my friend's mourning over the loss of his insurgent cousin, yearning, that is, for the historical and political redemption of what I thought was the violated commons to which we both belonged. When all of a sudden my friend reached down into the unconscious of his people and slapped me upside the head with a wet gym shoe, the startling realization that not only was I barred ab initio, that is, from the beginning, from the denouement of historical and political redemption, but that the borders of redemption are policed by whites and non-whites alike, even as they kill each other. It's worse than that. If I, as a black person, if person, subject, being, are appropriate words, since human is not, if I am both barred from the denouement of social and historical redemption and needed, if redemption is to attain any form of coherence, without the articulation of a common Negro phobogenesis that relays between Israel and Palestine, the narrative coherence of their bodily, of their bloody conflict would evaporate. My friends and his fellow Palestinians' Negro phobogenesis is the bedrock, the concrete slab upon which any edifice of human articulation, whether love or war, is built. Degraded humanity, that is, Palestinians, can be frisked by exalted humanity, that is, Ashkenazi Jews. And the walls of reason remain standing, notwithstanding the universal indignity of stop and frisk. But if that soldier is an Ethiopian Jew, I'm going to fast forward now from 32 to about 45 in the year 2001, and another such multiracial encounter. Well, I won't give any preamble because I think that it's explained in the text itself, and then we can and then we can go to conversation. February 2021. Actually, Ethan and I were in school together then. No, 2001. Yes. Right?
You have been a member.
Okay. Yes, we were, because you graduated in 05, and I graduated in 04, so this is exactly the time, yes. We were in, he says we were in one seminar together, I say we were in two, so. All right. 6 months before the Twin Towers fell, I drove Alice, a white woman I first dated upon return from living in South Africa for 5 years, then lived with and finally married, down the rugged coast to a conference in Santa Cruz called the Race Rave. The realization that Black suffering is of a different order than the suffering of other oppressed people, and that Black suffering is the life force of the world, was waiting for the two of us 80 miles down the road from Berkeley. Alice and I met in South Africa. One of my assignments as an underground insurgent was to spy on Americans who came to South Africa, to sidle up to them and find out why they were there, to then write dossiers for my underground handlers. This included attending American expatriate functions to suss out who might be tied to the US military or intelligence communities. I developed a knack for making people want to tell me about themselves, why they were there. When someone found out I was an American who was also an elected official in Mandela's party, they would sometimes reveal their agendas to me, not by directly divulging their agenda, but indirectly by the questions they asked me, which suggested how much they already knew about the inner workings of the ANC. Afterwards, I went home, stayed up till the wee hours of the morning, typing out my reports. This was low-grade intelligence, more dust and gossip than gold, that I passed up the food chain of Umkhonto we Sizwe. That's the name of the underground wing. It means spear of the nation. I only knew what was made of it on rare occasions, as when I found out an American businessman posing as an affirmative action consultant had at one time been an agent for the Department of the Treasury in the US and had worked in the Congo for the US puppet Mobutu Sese Seko. Alice was the subject of one of my reports when she was there on sabbatical. She arrived on sabbatical at the end of 1992 to do research for world literature courses she taught at a college in Northern California. Nadine Gordimer, the Nobel laureate fiction writer, and I had been friends and literary collaborators for a year when Alice arrived. I introduced her to Nadine right after Gordimer won the Nobel Prize for Literature. Excuse me. In February 2001, Alice and I attended the Race Rave Conference at the University of California, Santa Cruz. Between 200 and 300 activists, scholars, students, and people who were non-academic workers or precariously employed met to explore racism and the intersections of oppression, to promote reparations and healing, and to develop the framework for a truth and reconciliation process in the United States. It was billed as the first of a series of such gatherings on college campuses across the country. At the end of the day, we gathered in a large room. The two organizers told us to break into groups that reflected how we were seen by the police. This meant that there would be a white group, a Black group, a brown group, a red or Native American group, and a yellow group. I remember thinking, at last, now we'll move from a politics of culture to a culture of politics. The whispers sent out by a few of the Black people seated near me confirmed my feeling. A sister near me sighed as though she had been holding her breath for the past day and a half and said, "Now we get to talk." A brother seated in front of her chuckled, saying, "Didn't know Black was in their vocabulary." But the resistance started before the exercise started, and it didn't come from the whites. It came from the non-Black people of color, the yellows, the browns, the reds, who did not want to be known by their color, not even for 2 hours. They insisted that they were not simply colors, but cultural identities. In contrast, the blacks, spurred by our joy at the opportunity to speak about the way state violence functions in our lives, were already at the door. But the commotion in the center of the room made us turn and look back. It felt as though a seismic tremor had cracked the parquet floor, split the room in half, leaving a small group of slaves adrift by the door, while the humans argued about their cultural identities in the middle of the room. The non-black people of color were angry. In a scene not unlike my presentation in Berlin, a chapter earlier in the book, they demanded a say in how they were categorized. The organizers did their best to speak over those in the crowd who would not listen. They said that being pigeonholed was the whole point, that the police treated you as a color and ignored your cultural and ethnic singularities, and the point of the exercise was to assume that formation and see what came of the discussion. That's the exercise, let's get to it. Right on, roared up from the blacks waiting in the wings. And it might have gone down like that, but something unexpected happened. One group of people who had formed part of this scrum of discontent became more vocal than the rest. But they didn't voice their objections on the basis of cultural integrity. In fact, they mobilized the same term as the organizers, race. But they mobilized race in service to the aims and objectives of the non-black people of color who insisted on a politics of culture versus culture, the culture of politics that animated the black folks. It was weird, but it worked. They were biracial, one parent black, one parent white. And they didn't want to be pigeonholed as black, they said, though they didn't say that they would be just as irate if they had been pigeonholed as white. As I watched the so-called biracial, half-black, half-white people make their case for why they did not want to be grouped as black, I was struck by how their argument in no way resembled the logic of the people of color, and by how little that mattered, meaning no one checked them on this contradiction. Rather than assert the specificity of their cultural heritage and ethnic origins, and why the catch-all colors assigned to them would be an erasure of those cultural markers, the biracial people argued that the four colors, red, white, brown, and black, did not account for them. They were neither black nor white, they said. They were both, and as amalgamations, they deserved their own room. The organizers were stunned, stymied, but not by the argument. A child could have countered by simply saying, none of y'all look like zebras, and no pig would put you in a lineup of white perps. Okay. Well, no one laughed that day. Okay. Put you in a lineup of no pig would put you in a lineup of white perps or blast you in the shoulder instead of your heart because he could tell your mama was white. Y'all read black. So go to the black room and stop wasting our time. Perhaps the child would have said it without the clarity and rancor I've imposed, but nonetheless, it's not a difficult objection to handle, especially given the fact that the biracial people did not interrogate the assumptive logic as was the case with the others. They simply said, you haven't given us the right color room. So why did the organizers look like deer in headlights? And more importantly, what made them cave in? It was the affect. I think we were talking about affect today. We were, yes. It was the affect, the verve, the energy, the bodily performance of the biracial contingent. They postured and gesticulated in a manner more stereotypically black than biracial. In other words, their loud talk, their indignation, their runaway slave rage made the organizers quake. It was a different affect than the affect of the other people of color. The non-blacks had pleaded, whined, cajoled. The biracial contingent, however, to quote Queen Latifah, got buck with the motherfuckers. They pressed a hyperbolic NWA performance of blackness into service of their desire to be as far away from blackness as they could. and it worked like a charm. The organizers, confronted with the sound and fury of black rage, cynically divorced from black desire, gave the biracial people a room of their own. And by necessity, they caved into the other people who wanted to be grouped by culture, not color. Black affect, or the blaxploitation of black affect, had been weaponized for the death of black desire. Each group was given the same sheet of paper with the same instructions and discussion topics. The sheet of paper also included a charge. We were to come up with ways to talk about what happened in our groups with our allies when we returned to plenary 90 minutes later. The first thing that the blacks did when we were alone and the door was closed was to tear the sheet of paper up and throw it away. We realized that the regime of violence through which we were subjugated could not be reconciled with the regime of violence that subjugated our so-called allies. And what had happened in the auditorium confirmed this. In other words, what the organizers had unleashed was a realization that oppression has two, not one, regimes of violence: the violence that subjugates the subaltern and the violence that subjugates the slave or the black. Once we had liberated ourselves from the constraints of having to make our suffering analogous to the suffering of the people of color, something truly profound occurred. For me, someone who was beginning to move from Marxism to what would a year later be called Afropessimism, the session was instructive because I was able to see and feel how comforting it was for a room full of black people to move between the spectacle of police violence to the banality of microaggressions at work and in the classroom, to the experience of chattel slavery, as if the time and intensity of all three were the same. No one, absolutely no one, said, "Hey, hold on now." For example, when a young black woman said she was forced to breastfeed all the white people at her job, like she had done on the plantation, no one said, "You're speaking metaphorically, right?" The room simply said, "Amen," and right on. The time of chattel slavery was the time of our lives. And this was not a problem, as some psychoanalysts would have it, of a neurotic conflation between the imaginary and the symbolic. In other words, this was not a failure of our collective psyches to restore its state violence to relational logic, to separate, that is, the time of chattel slavery from the time of discrimination, or to separate the space of the whipping post from the cartography of the office. It was a collective recognition that the time and space of chattel slavery shares essential aspects with the time and space, the violence of our modern lives. Folks cried and laughed and hugged each other and called out for the end of the world. No one poured cold water on that call by asking, "Well, now, what does that mean, the end of the world? How can you say that? Where's that going to leave us? Or how will we make sense of the end of the world when we go back to speak with our allies?" The dangerous fuse of the black imagination had been lit by nothing more than the magic of an intramural conversation. No one wanted this conversation to end. With 30 minutes left in the session, a sense of dread began to set in. The organizers would soon be calling us back into that dreaded auditorium. Someone floated the idea of not returning, of just going home, but someone else came up with a better idea. We would go back in and refuse to speak with them. Not a protest, just a silent acknowledgement of the fact that we would not corrupt what we experienced with their demand for articulation between their grammar of suffering and ours. Now there was movement outside the door. We looked up, thinking that the organizers had recalled us early. But when we opened the door, we found that it wasn't the organizers, but the entire group of biracial people, people whose hyperbolic blackness had rescued them from our room. They were greeted with grunts and cold stares. One of them asked if they could come in. There was silence. I broke the silence by saying, "You never left." They entered and sat down cautiously. We made room for them just as cautiously. We asked them why they decided to join us. They told us that their discussion had centered on the presumptive notion that they could access the social capital of civil society. Their talk had been vertically integrated from discussions about what a special place on the US Census could mean for their mobility in civil society and their quest for recognition on what they had described as their own terms. From that to the gut-wrenching conflicts they experienced in the tussle of allegiance in their individual family lives. In other words, how do we honor both parents, our white and black cultural heritages? But this discussion did not have the gravitas needed for a full 90 minutes. So eventually they turned to the topic that they had been given, which is their relationship to and experience with police violence. And it wasn't long before they began to realize that to meditate on this question through their biracialism wasn't going to get them anywhere. No cop ever said, "Look here, I'm going to shoot you in the shoulder and not the heart because you're only half black." When we all returned to the plenary, the room took note of us, all of us. Someone said, "I want some of what that group has." But we had not spoken a word. Another person said, "Look at all that love." Still, we had not spoken. A third person said, "So what's up with y'all? Every one of you is glowing." The organizers asked us who had been designated as the spokesperson for the group. I raised my hand. They asked me for our report. "We have decided to remain silent," I said. They wanted to know why. "We have decided to remain silent," I repeated. "Can you say anything?" they asked. I said all that I had been mandated to say was, "We had a good session." "Well, we can see that," they said. Then they asked the biracial group to speak. One of them simply said, "We ended up joining the black group." The room was even more puzzled now, but no explanations were forthcoming. It went south from there. The whites from their group reported their bric-a-brac dialogue. Alice had had her head handed to her. No one in her room was willing to think of themselves as white in relation to policing. The white women said it was important to divide the room along gender lines and have a discussion about how women fare under patriarchy. Several people said they were Jewish and perhaps they should have pressed the organizers for their own room as the biracial people had done. One white man actually said that it was important for them to do a round robin in which each person would say what state they lived in before they came to California. You can't make this up. Nor can you make this up. To Alice's horror, damn near everyone in the room thought this was a very good idea. One by one, the white people began to shout out the names of the states where they were born and raised. That's what she said happened. Okay. One by one, the white people began to shout out the names of the states where they were born and raised, and they would have descended into personal narratives about how and when they came to California and what brought them there had my wife Alice not exploded. "This doesn't have a damn thing to do with our relationship to the institution of policing. Let's get back on track," she shouted. But no one was willing to get back on track. The interesting thing about the trajectory of the conversation in the white room was the way it uncannily mirrored the absolute refusal of the exercise that was going on in the black room, albeit for different reasons. Alice was shut down because the exercise threatened the most constituent elements of whiteness. White people are the police. This includes those white people who, like Alice, at the level of consciousness, do not want their birthright deputization. At a deep, unconscious level, they all intuited in that room the fact that the police were not out there, but in here. That policing was woven into the fabric of their subjectivity. No wonder the discussion veered in myriad directions away from a conscious encounter with this horrifying aspect of their structural position into a chorus of declarations about gendered identities and stories about their individual sojourns to California. And conversely, the black people in their room at the other end of the hall understood that no kind of psychic or material immigration would ever be expansive enough to open such doors to them, to Alice and her people. But for the non-black people of color, the question of access to civil society remained an open one. The Asians and Latinos and Native Americans' discussions had begun with questions of violence and ended with questions of access, immigration policy, Spanish in the schools, questions of indigenous gambling casinos, and the question of land and sovereignty. It was clear that the articulation was between the whites, whose access to civil society was so unquestioned that they had no reason to complain about it or even question the regime of violence that fortified and extended it, and between their junior partners, who were anxious for expanded access. What they embodied were gradations of marginalization. The antagonism was not between them and the police, but between them, and all of us, even the ones who had wanted their own room and came in later to join us. Even the two organizers were wrong, which is to say that the exercise was right, if only accidentally right. The organizers had divided people based on their color, on how the gaze of the police perceives them, but only one group of people is essentially elaborated and subjected by this kind of gratuitous violence, the blacks, the slaves. For all the other groups of people, there is a certain contingency that interrupts as well as makes legible the violence of the state. These people must transgress or be perceived to transgress the law before the anvil of state violence falls on their heads. For the blacks, the slaves, no notion of transgression is necessary. The pleasure of maiming black bodies is its own reward. It is this pleasure that divided the conference not into five colors, but into two species, blacks and humans. But the cognitive maps of the people at the race rave conference could not comprehend or explain this a priori species division between the human and the slave. The black people, and ultimately the biracial black people, knew this, if only for the most part intuitively. But the terrain was not fertile enough for that knowledge to flourish. The black people were shackled to the cognitive maps of their well-meaning masters. Now, it would be mendacious and even misguided to say that the Patriot Act and Homeland Security do not affect black people, or to champion an anti-immigration sentiment of any sort. But it would also be misguided and mendacious to suggest that these laws like the Patriot Act and the relative corruption of the integrity of the Bill of Rights, or the relative rigidity or elasticity of civil society to and within the institutions of civil society, can help us think through black folks' unique grammar of suffer. Put another way, black thought, and therefore black liberation, is threatened not only by the state, but by the interests and the actions of the loyal opposition, otherwise known as the progressive left. First, there is the terrorism of what Antonio Gramsci referred to as political society, the police, the army, the prison industrial complex. Second, there is the terror of civil society's hegemonic blocs, its clusters of filial formations like the mainstream media, the university, and the megachurch. But there is also a third tier of terror, the one that was in that room in Santa Cruz, which is a terror with which black thought must contend. And that is the terror of counter-hegemonic and revolutionary thought, the logic of white feminism, the logic of working class struggle, the logic of multiracial, cultural and racial coalitions, the logic of immigrant rights, the unrelenting terror elaborated whenever black people's so-called allies think out loud. The stakes of this three-tiered terror are high because their impact upon black people's capacity to capture and be captured by our own imaginations. These three tiers scaffold the death of black desire and our capacity to to imagine and to fantasize while assuming our position is imbricated in our capacity to think theoretically, to give political desire to our objective value. Thank you. What do you have, Ethan, about 30 minutes?
I'm not sure what time it is.
It's 7:30.
So yeah. About 30 minutes for questions. I'd love to have you all in the meeting.
Just burning up. Or comments, anything. Oh, yes.
I was just wondering about the distinction you made between politics, culture, and culture of politics, and then having
that. Yeah, I've told you that I was in your dad's, and I were in class together, and there was another person in class, Amanda Lawshaw, who actually gave me, so I have to say that I got that from Amanda Lawshaw, because it was not my phrase. I give her credit for it in my first book. So I guess what I'm trying to say, the difference between, she said one day in a reading group, I think what we're trying to get at is a culture of politics, where what has happened since the Reagan era is that political movements have moved into a politics of culture. And so, What I would say is that when I was coming up, you know, the people who educated me politically were, you know, like the American Indian Movement started 20 blocks from my house, and because of my father's work at the university, I met a lot of the people and Russell Means and had lots of conversations as a teenager, and then SDS were people that taught me. Teachers in my high school, and the Panthers had after-school school, you know, so coming from those people, this would not have been a problem back in that day, because everyone was interested in the destruction of the state, everyone was interested in where they fit in a paradigm of oppression, but things have shifted 30 years later in terms of now the desire was a desire to be known as a kind of cultural identity, and that leads you implicitly or explicitly into a kind of political agenda that is geared more towards access to what exists than thinking about destruction of what exists. And so this is, you know, and it's no one's fault. It's actually, you know, the people in the room, I was 45, you know, my wife was about 60 something, they would have no idea of that history. And COINTELPRO and the Reagan era destroyed, you know, everything that motivated critical thought to think about revolution. And also, if you read, I'm sorry, I have a senior moment here. There is a book about how the CIA worked to promote people like Foucault and others, and I don't poo-poo Foucault's work, but in other words, the Soviets were doing a lot of political work to produce book conferences, theater, arts, and what the CIA was trying to do is how can we help promote the dissemination of a certain kind of politics and a certain kind of critical theory that asks questions about individual subjectivity as opposed to questions about state power. And it's actually to the point where there's, you know, if you go on YouTube, there are actually CIA agents who talk about this, and they will actually say some of the books that come out of this era, we actually commissioned, you know. Another person says, well, can you tell us who did? No, I cannot tell you which one, you know. So what I'm trying to say is that the crushing of the movement crushed something inside of the academy where thought was no longer weaponized for broad kinds of revolutionary thinking, began to be weaponized for thinkings about how one fits into a certain type of And I think these are important things to think about, but what I'm also trying to say is that it was a crowding out scenario. The specificity of identity produced a crowding out scenario for rage against the machine. And that's what hopefully Afropessimism is trying to get us back to. Thank you for that. That's because I did not explain that to begin with. That's a very important point. Appreciate it. Thank you. Others?
I'll ask you a question.
Okay. Sure, Ethan.
Break the silence. So I always first just want to say thank you so much for your talk. It was really great. The readings that you did for us, I know you with each one of them, and the bass you gave one is hilarious. And it's a really great piece. But there's a question I've been wanting to ask.
Sorry, can everybody hear in the back? Yeah, okay.
So you're touching often this multiracial mulatto here. And we talked about it a little bit yesterday. You talked about your interaction with Jared Sexton.
Mm-hmm.
So I teach a Fuller course, and I started building it off Jared Sexton's work, where he's just really, I was like, I agree with it. And it fits with my personal experience, just being very critical of this idea of multiracial, right? And how it works as an anti-Black discourse.
Yeah.
But I also have spent a lot of time looking at how people like me, lighter skinned Negroes, move through the world, and you say, a cop will differentiate and shoot you in the shoulder. But when I look at this isn't an Afro-pessimist question, this is the problem, is that I keep looking at all of the experiences for the light-skinned Negro in the world of the mulatto, and I keep seeing that, they're not in jail as much, and they're not getting those longer sentences, and they have higher levels of education, and da 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 da. So it appears to me that they're not getting shot in the shoulder. They're getting shot in the shoulder. And so I was just wondering, how does that fit into what you're saying?
Well, that.
What am I missing?
No, you're not missing anything. First of all, did everyone hear? So the lived experience of someone whose lighter skin is going to be different than the lived experience of someone whose darker skin. And it could, as you're saying, it's often very different even in the moment of policing. And I think that's a very good intervention because Afropessimism is dealing at a level of abstraction, at least most of my work, that does not attend to your question. It doesn't mean that I disagree with you. But if you read the Afropessimism of Jared Sexton, he does attend to the lived experience as a person whose mother is white and his father is Black, to that. But he doesn't. Address it in a kind of roundabout way. The point that I would make is not to refute the evidence. The evidence is there. The evidence is in my family. I'm sure it's every Black person's family. I have my grandfather, Frank Sr., fortunately for me, was my complexion, but he had straight hair, and his brothers were much lighter than you, and they had straight hair, and so they left the swamp where they actually lived, right where 12 Years a Slave was made, and they were able to leave and go get master's degrees at USC. One became an Italian insurance man in New Orleans, And, but the point that I would make would not refute that. It would simply go back to something that Hortense Spillers wrote about when she talked about the three types of women who suffer under white patriarchy. There's the white lady whose sexual body is preserved for the appropriate sexual encounters of marriage. There is the Black African who is so in the libidinal gaze of the master is without sexuality at all, And this is precise, and it is that absence of sexuality that allows for the breeding of black people on an industrial scale, so that we have 389,000 black people at the end of the Revolutionary War, and about 30 years later, there are 4 million, because under force of death and bodily mutilation, people have been forced to copulate, and that is the African female. Yeah, she doesn't even say woman. But in between that, there is, in quotations, the mulatto concubine. Now, the point that she makes is precisely the point that you're making, but she makes it, your question solicits her in two different ways. One is to say that their lived experience is much different than the African female, because they're not addressed as unsexed or so hyperly sexed that there is no sex. They're addressed as concubines and put into, nice, quote, mistress's apartments in New Orleans and that kind of thing. And if another white planter would insult that woman, they would fight out a duel. So the level of preconscious interest, in Freud's early topography, these white people are looking at them as being different than the African. But they are also not free from the structure of social death. They have actually been, and what Spooler makes the point, and Sexton then carries it forward, is that the hand, metaphorically speaking, of white civil society reaches down into the mass of Africanness and produces these differences. The fact that people themselves take it into themselves, say, I am biracial, and will tell you that they have articulated their identity, is just not true. Historically, the need for this middle figure, as suppose, ebbs and flows with the intensity of black resistance to the world. And so when there's a, because when I was in college, this thing wasn't an issue. It was black power and everybody was black and, some were light and some, and it was precisely the 60s and the 70s, and as the Joint Chiefs of Staff said to Richard Nixon, you cannot have another troop deployment of 200,000 because we're going to need them right here to fight what's going on. It's that allows for the general imagination of white civil society to reach down into the world of massified blackness and then re-intensify these color divisions as though they are identities. And the fact that people take them on as identities is just a matter of them being swept up in this move of history. So when we calm down and when they pacified us, might dissipate again like it was in 1969. but you're absolutely, so the treatment is different. And as Phil was just saying with these three types of women, it really is. But what the biracial figure never understands is that they are not human agents. They are tropes of someone else's agenda. They have been created. Good point. Oh, sorry, yes. Question related to recent Supreme Court events, or?
I think so, and also Roberta's own research and classes is on reproductive justice and black communities and specifically equity issues around reproductive justice.
Well, I think there are two This isn't my field, but I think that there are two levels at which to think about this. And I'll do it rather associationally. I mean, clearly, if what happens, what we think is going to happen happens, it's going to hurt a tremendous amount of people, and it's going to hurt a lot of black women terribly, you know, the end of abortion rights. So at the level of policy, I'm all for it. I've never been pro-life. I believe that if you look at 1959, when Margaret Randall, the revolutionary poet, went to Cuba and began interviewing women and saying, well, what did the Cuban Revolution do for you? And, about 9 out of 10 of them said, I can get an abortion and I can get a divorce. So that tells you something about, and so I think that is extremely necessary to have available for black women and poor women. But I also think that we have to understand that there are ways in which much of the so-called women's movement needs to be recategorized and theoretically divided between a certain kind of black feminism that has informed me from people like Christina Sharp and the person who was my dissertation advisor, C.D.R. Hartman, and Hortense Spillers, and another kind of feminism that I think at an essential level cannot be reconciled, which is which I was also trained in white psychoanalytic feminism, which doesn't call itself white, it calls itself psychoanalytic by Kaja Silverman. What I'm trying to say is that where Silverman and I have always disagreed is that before we can think about, or let me say, as we think about the problem of reproductive rights, we also have to think about in the collective unconscious, there's no such thing as a black father, there's no such thing as a black mother, there's no such thing as black children, the black family doesn't exist. And it's always there, whether symptomatically articulated as in the first chapter of Asada Shakur, when she's shot 3 bullets in her chest and she's chained to a bed and the cops are beating her, and the cop says the most theoretically lucid statement, he's a dunderhead, but didn't study theory, but she says, I need to call my mother. He says, oh, you have a mother? And that is the consistency of genealogical isolation or natal alienation. And so the whole image production of, from my teenage years when Roe v. Wade is passed to the present, is not founded on the iconography or the specificity of the problems of black women. It's founded on the images and the specificity of the problem of white women. And certainly, as a policy, it does benefit black women, but it does not allow us to think through the fact that black women have babies and their children belong to the state.
Thank you.
Sure. Yes. Yeah.
So I've been moved from the South. The history with my great uncle, he told the history of our last name. It was very similar. Makes me a little bit emotional.
Yeah, I heard it.
Thinking about that,
yeah.
How do you carry on the name knowing the history?
Fortunately, marijuana is legal in Oregon and California. That's a glib, smart-ass answer, but there are some days where I just can't face the material. Which is precisely why Afropessimism explores this question and offers nothing for that. I just, and now I'm not being glib with you. I mean, in other words, why I made the film was because I was also working in a black, I'd say a black person's retirement home in Oakland. There was one non-black person, Yuri Kochiyama, who was an Asian revolutionary who was in her 80s. She was there, and I guess people are maybe young, but she actually held Malcolm X as he was bleeding on the stage of the Audubon Ballroom. So I got, she was part of his movement at that time. But other than that, it was basically a black retirement home. And what I could see in, a group of us were helping them to produce a newsletter every month on their lives and whatever they wanted to, you know, like a newspaper kind of thing. And what I could see was a life lived without recognition and incorporation. In other words, a life lived, some of the people had been working class, some people had been poor, some people had been middle class, but they all shared what the people in this film shared, which is to say years of moving through the world as though they didn't exist. And the only thing about being retired and being in this home was that every day there are no distractions like going to work, and one must think about that all the time. Patrice Douglas, who is an Afro-pessimist feminist at University of California, Berkeley, once asked me, she was a student in a seminar I was teaching, and she said, you know, how, Frank, are we going to keep Afro-pessimism black? And what she was referring to was the fact that the first wave, you know, like Meja, Sexton, Hartman, and David Merritt, people were just getting hammered. I mean, we could tell you horror stories about what it meant to be a grad student and a professor. You know, I almost didn't pass my oral examination because of this material. Now the second wave then comes when Trayvon Martin is killed, and then we've got, you know, Mike Brown, Sandra Bland, Eric Garner, you know, and all of a sudden, not all of a sudden, but over a period of less than 10 years, you have something that most black academics really, really desire in their lives and never comes to fruition, which is that this highly abstract material, which is precisely why I wrote this book as part memoir and part theory, this highly abstract graduate student material is being read in townships of Kailiche in Cape Town, in Soweto by a mass revolutionary movement that at that time was called Black First, Land First, in Bahia, in Brazil, in the Movement for Black Lives organization in Vienna, which I didn't even know they had enough black people for that kind of thing, you know. And so it's connecting with the streets. In other words, it's moving like wildfire through the grassroots black community in the way, like in 1869 to 1879, the academics were saying that Das Kapital was all rubbish and the working class was getting dictionaries and reading it in the factories, okay? And now that made it relevant, okay? Because it's either relevant to you because you're worried, like some university professors, that black kids are gonna burn their place down. You know, or you're truly interested. But being truly interested is not always a blessing, because what it means is that then something else begins to happen, which is like hip hop and with jazz, it becomes the possession of all others, and there's no line back to the people who did it. This is what happened to intersectionality, which was a black feminist thing. And I have students who have no knowledge of that, okay? And so as Patrice Douglas said, how can we keep Afro-pessimism black? Then it came back to me, it's just like our names, it's just like our bodies. We exist a priori as psychic or real possessions of everyone else. And, you know, now when I go to Europe, there's sexy white guys, you know, in theoretical departments who are better off a pessimist than I am. You know, it's like, there it is. Jazz is no longer a black music, it's an American music. Hip hop is a people's music, it's not a black music. And well, goddamn, one day Afropessimism will just be a theory, just like Wilderson. It's an arbitrary designation which expresses me as an extension, not of my agency, but as the dear Hartman says, I am an extension of the master's prerogative. Now, that's the bad news. The good news is that there are always black people between the ages of 18 and sometimes 30 who are ready to move on this without care of what happens. And the problem in our community is that normally people in their 60s, like me, don't honor that highly iconoclastic rage. This, as in my first chapter, unless you're well retired or young, this being mad at the world, because the world exists because we do not. That's the argument of Afropessimism, that world making is parasitic on blackness. And we have tried to think through that rage as a theoretical project, as opposed to what most scholars do, which is to try to produce a kind of anger management and redirect that into something positive. You know, this is where I disagree at the level of affect with someone like Henry Louis Gates, who will say, the Cuban Revolution was great, but they burned down the entire infrastructure as they moved through. And I said, no, the problem is that they didn't cross over to Florida and start burning there. Yes.
Yes, hey, thank you very much. Yeah. Let's see, one and two.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, it's like almost like a slight personal question. I've lived in South Africa.
Yeah.
And, it seems like, well, it's also weird to think that you might have been sort of overtly assessing me while I was there. But the time difference.
What city were you in?
I was in Cape Town.
No, then we never met. But any American who came through Johannesburg, I was teaching at different universities, and the Papa Bush had told the moderates in the ANC, we'll give you $26 million if you get rid of all the communists in the ANC. And Shell Oil gave the ANC a building. So there's a tremendous amount of internecine violence in the ANC because there were those of us who wanted to take all the wealth and redistribute it. And so we had a lot of American researchers and people coming through who are also working for the state, and they were really trying to find out, was this going to go socialist or not? So I just made myself available and tried to figure out who's who and write dossiers on. So I did not write one on you. I don't remember meeting you. Continue, please. It does, and I can see that there's another question in the back. It's a highly complex question, but you're right on target in the general problematic, in the sense that one of the things that you experienced in terms of policy in Cape Town was that the apartheid state allowed Cape Town to become what was called a brown town. And that is because it's a major, major destination for Germans and other Europeans, and you know, the property values and the false bay in Indian Ocean and the Atlantic coast. And so the Xhosas were shoved into basically a sand pit, you know, in Khayelitsha, and domestic work in Johannesburg is done by Africans. And, you know, for years, domestic work in Cape Town, it was heavily policed, is done by so-called coloreds. In addition, they speak, many of them speak Afrikaans. And so that was another example of a kind of production of division. It was, I think, engineered also by the fact that they were having difficulty in, hundreds of years ago enslaving the Xhosas. And so they went to the Malay, and there was intermingling, Malaysia and intermingling and producing, because Cape coloreds are different historically than Johannesburg coloreds, but also intermingled and the same. But you do see that in side of ANC meetings at the branch level, at the sub-regional level. I was the political commissar for, it would be like an area of Los Angeles and its surrounding suburbs, you know. And they had more authority inside these meetings than Africans did. There is this tension in the Group Areas Act, which forced people in the 1960s to move into townships based upon these designations, only exacerbated that. So yes, there was someone behind you. I don't know if the person left or not. Okay. All right. So you, yes, right up here.
One, two.
No, you, and then him.
Okay.
No, you're right. Then the guy in front of you. Yeah. Yeah. Yes.
And then you have this horrible plot that you talked about with Reagan, and it turns into culture, positive culture.
Yeah.
It feels to me, and this may be super naive, and this is what I want to get your read on. It feels to me like there was a moment after George Floyd's murder where reparation back on the table.
Yeah.
And there was this attempt to, it could have been some culture politics. But the backlash has been so horrendous and so strong, and the reverse racism stuff is now getting institutionalized.
Yeah.
And the Attorney General came in saying that sort of the way theory is racist.
Yeah.
Right? I mean, so this horrible backlash is trying to hold on to this idea of some kind of, you know, the missing to mark because they're being colorblind. It's like, check it. Return to colorblindness is a way to return to a politics of culture and refuse of politics.
Say the last part again, because I just, or just cast it a little differently so I can actually process.
Yeah, the choices are so bad. Started because there was a day in which black people on campus and white people weren't. That was a tradition. And attempt to, the reverse racism stuff, and the attempt to talk about civil, weaponizing civil rights stuff against that moment in the 60s.
Yeah.
That we're in, and I feel like it's just tragic because there was it's a reaction to things like reparations.
Yeah.
That could cause real distribution and real change.
I understand what you're saying. Okay. So you're asking what I think?
What do you think?
I don't want to tell you what I honestly think.
What I honestly think, and then I'm going to be honest, and then I'll come back, is that I'll be 70 in 4 years, and I have done a lot and risked a lot, and I want to move somewhere else. That's what I honestly think. Fortunately or unfortunately, because I was a bum teaching adjunct for so many years and being in South Africa, I cannot afford to retire anytime soon. Like, I mean, there are people my age who have been retired for 4 years. I can't, someone in my class is actually the head of like General Electric. He's worth $150 million. Another person has a $79 million net worth. I have a negative net worth. And a decent salary, but because I haven't actually had a real job for most of my life and lived all of these places, that real job doesn't gonna translate into a retirement income that, you know. But I think we're in a messed up time. I think as you articulate, there's so many contradictions. And this is the problem. Here's what I'm not doing. I'm not condemning Martin Luther King and the civil rights movement. What I am saying is that what Afropessimism tries to do is learn from the reaction of civil society and the state when Black people simply ask for something that is minuscule, you know? And the response is as though you've come in with an AK-47. And that's one thing. The other thing is, it's back to, and I'm sorry, back there with the hat on. Who asked me the question about the name? What's your name again?
Chris.
Yeah,
it's
what Chris was saying about names actually goes into Black civil rights discourse. Now DeSantos can pick it up and make it his. You know, now, you know, I sent my wife, I was joking, she didn't think it was funny, okay. It was there's a thing called Moms for Liberty. it's all these white women who have spread like wildfire. There's a chapter almost everywhere, you know. And these are moms who meet in Germany. They call it Kaffeeklatsch, you know, where you meet for coffee and dessert, you know, to actually analyze why they need to destroy critical race theory. And so this is just kind of echoing what you're saying. They're actually able to articulate a victim discourse based upon the proliferation of an analysis of oppression. That is profound, as Don King used to say, only in America, you know what I'm saying? and they're gonna come back to, Trump's coming back to the White House as a victim. I mean, it's because, you know, if we are trying to build a discourse of analysis that is such a brutal horse pill that they can't swallow it, but you know, there are edgy white critical theorists, as I said, in who are taking Afropessimism and trying to think through something that is not Black. I mean, it's harder to do than with civil rights discourse, but the entire lexicon of civil rights discourse has been appropriated by the most powerful racists to put out a victim narrative, which they fundamentally believe in. They fundamentally believe in, and they have the power to proliferate it. I mean, it's the only thing for Black people to do is to refuse the engagement. But I mean, a lot of people are gonna die. I mean, that's just the cold truth about it. There's just gonna be a lot more blood on the floor. Or you're gonna have to shut up and go back to the way it was before Emmett Till was killed, because they're bringing their sense of victimization alongside of, you know, bolstered by the largest military police industrial complex in the world, and they're going to use it. And I do think they're coming back to the White House. I mean, I don't. And the reason that they're coming back is because there's no fundamental difference between them and the Democrats. They just do a lot of stuff the Democrats can't stomach. But at the end of the day, I mean, they're just simple things that the Democrats could do to position themselves as being different. You know, I mean, it kind of used to happen. You know, where you know, I mean, not really, but kind of used to sort of let. You know, I mean, now I'm getting myself in quicksand here. You know, because I'm thinking about, you know, LBJ just like boom with civil rights and killing a million Vietnamese at the same time. You know, but now, you know, once Nixon took the dollar off the gold standard in the 1970s, there's actually no meaning to being president, except what your meaning is that you're an agent for all these other forces. And the Democrats understand that at a certain point in time, they were an agent for a kind of Keynesian social democracy. They had the dollar and they owned the gold and they could do stuff with that. Now the gold and the dollar has disappeared, so everyone in some way has to be a puppet of the corporate world. I mean, there's no other choice. And at the same time, these people have to stop blacks from voting, and these people can't get in unless all the black people vote and vote one way. But these people don't give a damn about black people once they get the vote. You know, I mean, it's madness. And so, because if they gave a damn, then they would lose some of their white support, and they would actually violate their own sense of integrity. I mean, they're just really, really simple things. Now Biden's got COVID, he can see on the horizon that it's either DeSantis or Trump. Those are our choices. And he can also see that, he could barely sit through a correspondence dinner as Trevor Noah. You know, I was like, dude, drink some coffee or something. You know, I mean, it was like, put a stick back, prop him up. And then what is going to happen? The real energy is going to come up when Kamala Harris tries to run, the horrifying anti-misogynistic, misogynoir violence will come. I mean, it'll just be, but who else will they have? Someone like him? You know, they cannot be decisive. And they don't want to be ultra-racist, but they can't be loyal to black people, but they need all black people's votes. And they can't even help the working class. I mean, look how long does it take them to waffle over student loans. I mean, if he had done that on day one, he could have had the youth, rocking behind him for the past couple of years. They don't want to win. So it's the project was doomed from the very beginning because it had no ethical basis. Yes?
So Frank, you're well...
So we got one more. Yeah,
she's got a role here. As my daughter would say, "Daddy, you talk more shit than a radio." You know. Okay, one last question, I guess, right here.
So, when it comes down to your works, there's a lot of things there that actually gave words to what most of us experienced, but just don't. We didn't have the capacity. I didn't have the capacity beforehand. And there's always been this kind of troubling sensation that comes with this, not because of the fact that I expect philosophy or any of that to actually give me an answer, but where is the way home back to this? Because we are inherently corpses in the eyes of our society, and pleading out the ideas of actual recognition or pointing out these flaws, it doesn't do anything for us. Historically, we pose like these questions, but when you make the statement, like, it's only met with, like, well, I am not, and this is not, and you were wrong. What are we supposed to do here? Like, are we left to, last gust of screaming? Like, do we have to write this on every wall that we pass? Like, it's kind of like an overwhelming thought to kind of sit with, where you know what the reality is, but where is it left?
Okay.
So I would say there's a way in which you're right, and there's a way in which maybe there's a people. For my sins, I was a stockbroker for 8 years, and I lost about 100 brain cells. But I fundamentally believe, coming out of Dartmouth College, that I had a place and I could do something, and I would go somewhere. But what I found was that I was losing the capacity to understand my own situation. I had been a greater intellectual in high school when my teachers were black activists, and I went to a lab school on a university campus, and white people in SDS, and I was a less intellectual, 15 years later, working in the corporate world. I think there's something valuable about being able to walk through the world, and it's like the first time I made it through Das Kapital, I then went back into Macy's and I could see blood dripping from the clothes racks, there's something about that. This is a pessimism, Afropessimism, but it's not an emotional dispensation. To rob from Gramsci, it's a pessimism of the intellect, which is to say a pessimism of the grand narratives of liberation to think through black suffering. But there's also, as Gramsci would say, an optimism of the will, which is an optimism of something, which I cannot name, that can come out of the movement of black youth that will undo this in some way. Now, the undoing is going to be so catastrophic because the doing, the doing took 1,300 years, starting with the Arabs in East Africa and moving to the Portuguese. I mean, the doing of the making of blackness as the parasitic host of world identity took so much blood and so much violence, but it was not ordained by God. It was not a divine dispensation. It was made by sentient beings, and it can be unmade by sentient beings. So I'm still a revolutionary. It's just I don't know, like when I used to teach Marxism to the Communist Party workshops in underground cells, I don't know what that looks like on the other side of it. But I do know that it was constructed, and it can be undone. And the first steps towards undoing is understanding what it really is. And I don't know if how long that's going to take, but I think there's something valuable. Something happens to me when a group of people who are basically black Austrians say, will you come to Vienna and do a 3-hour workshop on Afropessimism because of shit that's going down in Vienna. And it's just rewarding. It's a kind of communication. We're able to talk. Our experience of anti-blackness is so irreconcilable, dissimilar, not similar, but our capacity to think at a higher level of abstraction about how it is the same thing, that's something that I think Afropessimism has contributed on a global scale. I mean, I get emails from Brazil, Venezuela, South Africa, Nigeria. There are other people coming up who are going to be doing these things, and that's also rewarding. And so something, I really have optimism in this thing called black resistance, but I don't know what exactly that's going to look like. And I do know, as I was saying, earlier, a minute ago, that it's going to be, it's on the, yes, indeed. Yeah. Because today, these white people are not fucking around. You know what I'm saying? They're saying, it is 1830 all over again. We're coming for our shit. Okay, so.
Thank you, Frank.
All right.
Can we give
him a good hand? Thank you. Oh, thank you.
Okay. Oh,
the FBI is listening. I'm not saying.